Hello, everyone. My name's Sean Ronaldo. I'm the moderator today. This is ADE Music Talk. And you probably know this already, but sharing the stage with me is Jeff Mills. So you've had a very full day. You got an early start this morning at the Rembrandt House doing a special project. Why don't you tell us a bit about it? We're going to be seeing some, I think they're going to put it on, it was broadcast on the web today. We're going to see some footage from that. We're going to be listening to some of the music that you recorded. But tell us a bit about the project and how it was presented to you in the first place.
An idea that came to me a few years ago about taking electronic music and going into a significant place to translate the feeling of being there. So, I had recently had a residency at the Louvre in Paris, and was around many artifacts during that whole process. So, I was really thinking about the idea, came to Amsterdam for a meeting once, and the idea was brought that perhaps maybe there's something that can be done in the Rembrandt House, so connections were made, and they thought it was an interesting idea, and I took a tour of the place, and then when we got to the studio where Rembrandt painted, I thought that maybe the acoustics of the room might be interesting if I can try to find a way to be able to somehow kind of extract that or to try to mix it in with music, then maybe I could be successful in that. So that happened this morning, and we're going to play it as a backdrop as soon as we get it up.
So the video here is what people might have watched. You started at 9 a.m. this morning.
Yeah.
And we're basically in that room for 4 hours. And maybe, actually I'm gonna go back. When you first went to the Rembrandt House and toured it the first time, what was your impression of the space and what made you feel like this could be an inspiring locale for you to make music?
Well, it was. The Rembrandt, the Rembrandt House, and his life in this space was quite impressive. I mean, even then, to have a whole house, I think of four or five floors was exceptional for an artist, and apparently he was a very good businessman. Though he went bankrupt, but he was very active in marketing his paintings. So he painted on the third floor. He sold the art on the first floor. He had a school and taught students on the floor above his studio. His family lived there. Everything was there. He was fully contained. So when I first toured it, I understood that this was someone who obviously was very knowledgeable about his field. He knew all the aspects of it and knew that it was important to keep everything in house so he could be inspired by his students. He could inspire his students. He had a showroom on the first floor so he could see what was selling and what was not. He knew when to move from scenery paintings to portraits and so on. So it's quite impressive to be there.
Did you have all this Rembrandt knowledge before the project, or did you have to do research ahead of time?
No, not more than I suppose the average person. So, but when I was offered the idea to do it, then I began to do research. About Rembrandt, and not just him, but also who his influences were, like the painter Leiden, for instance, who he studied a lot, and kind of mapped out his whole career to see how he you know, he kind of was influenced by certain styles and certain,
So from an aesthetic perspective, you know, when you were in the Louvre or even before that, like, was there anything about his work that drew you to it or you found particularly inspirational in the work itself?
Yeah, well, I mean, a lot of his work would be, I suppose, in the place of, say, a photographer, a landscape photographer today. So he really excelled at capturing a scene or the moment or the the frame, and he was exceptionally good at that. And at a time when there were other exceptionally good painters in Holland and Amsterdam at the time as well, but he was very good at marketing his work. So so it was when I began to do research, it was very clear that he excelled at that, and that the detail in the paintings was enough for me to be able to try to imagine how I could place sound to the depth of field, the texture that he used, the colors, how he used dark versus light, and all those things. So.
When you talk about, you know, being impressed by his marketing ability and keeping him sort of being this self-contained commercial entity or artistic entity in a way, did you feel sort of a kinship in that way? Because, I mean, I feel like you run your own label, release the vast majority of all your own music. You're very much an independent figure with a storied career.
Well, I think that any person, not just a musician and a painter, but anyone that makes something for people we all have something in common. We all look at similar signs from the public to know the temperature or how to gauge what people are thinking and how they're feeling. So, my perspective as a musician was probably very much, the same as Rembrandt as a painter or anyone else.
So the concept of, you know, being in a space and translating that into music, it's not the most obvious translation, I think, for most people. So how do you approach it? Like, how do you approach going into a room, and what elements are inspiring you to, and what are they inspiring you to do? Like, what's the math, so to speak?
Right. Well, I mean, speaking, I mean, maybe the people here that are DJs can relate to this much more. You, as a DJ, you develop a certain way of looking at your audience in ways that I guess the average person doesn't think so much about. When you have 1,000 people in front of you, it's really hard to focus on one particular person. So you look at a group of people as almost like a frame, and you learn how to measure the movements, the face expressions, the wave, I suppose, of an audience. This is what I've developed over time. And so then when you look at something like a painting, you can very much kind of translate this frame. You know, you can say, well, on the left side of the room is a little bit darker than the right. So on the left side of the speakers is more low end. On the right side is more high end. I'm going to use all black keys on the left side of the stereo field. It may not make sense, but it has to be logical for me in order to be able to get started with it. So I did those things in order to be able to understand. So when I went into the room, I looked at how things were positioned. The lighting was quite important, which was all on the left side. And then also he mixed his color, his paint on the right side of the room, But there was no window on that side. So I would imagine that he really depended a lot on the light on the left side, and there's where the canvas was, and also the subject in which he was probably painting. So the man and the woman he was painting, and so I had imagined that he probably painted the earlier hours of the day because of the sunlight. But then later I found that he actually painted by candlelight as well, a little bit. So I looked at the room as a frame and put that in a stereo field. So most of the activity is more on the left side, so most of the sound will be on the left side and more empty on the right side. His canvas was one-third inside of the room, so the distance between the wall was about one-third. So I was trying to interpret that in terms of a reverb and delay and so on. The room is made of wood, so it has a certain resonance that I was trying to capture for the crystal acoustical recording. Those are a few things.
So going into the project, you set the parameters of being in this space and having, 4 hours of time. I assume normally when you're making music, you wouldn't limit yourself in that fashion to, finishing a track or finishing an album or finishing anything within 4 hours. How is the experience of having like these parameters and limits, how does that affect your workflow or your creative process?
Well, actually, I can. I'm quite lucky. I can produce a lot of music in a very short period of time. So I can, in 4 hours. I mean, if I were in my studio, where I'm used to working, I can in 4 hours. I can maybe make 25 tracks, at around five minutes a piece, roughly. And I'm in the studio every day. For at least 4 to 6 hours, seven days a week.
So you have a lot of music that you're sitting on.
Basically the music that I've only officially released is a very small percentage of the music that I make, and a lot of it never leaves the studio. So
let's talk about, looking at the video here, just like the setup of the room and what your workflow is like. Like, you see here, may tell us, like, what did you bring for your technical setup? It doesn't look, it looks pretty stripped down.
Yeah, it's pretty simple because I intended on actually playing the synths, not just programming them, but actually playing them. And so it's just a chord, I think it's an X3 workstation and two smaller synths and no drum machine, because I wanted to have to make those frequencies in another way. So I would use a synthesizer to create something that would be similar to drums, but not a drum machine, because I'm working on a project that's about a period, and I didn't want to have too much that would date the composition. So I didn't want to have a 808 or a 909, because people with electronic music are so used to hearing that sound. I thought that maybe I could create something with a synthesizer that was something in between a note and a chord and a percussive sound. So,
but at the same time, you were not seeking to make dance music during this experience.
Well, there's no dancing anywhere here, so it's not about dancing at all. To emphasize this, I make more music for film and contemporary dance and cinemixes than I do dance music. And I'm constantly making dance music. So you know, I'm finding many other reasons in order, you know, to make music in general. So just to clarify that.
I mean, along those lines, you've done a lot of conceptual projects like this over the last 10, 15 years. And I'm curious, you know, many of them not dance music. What about like a conceptual project attracts you?
Well, it's of course, you know, the challenge, because you know, trying to describe anything with sound is, you know, it's not easy, and then you have to really know how to find things in the machines in order to be able to interpret it. But the fact that the subjects of these projects appeal to more people other than people that just like dance music, so I can play this for my older brother who no longer goes out, and he would understand it the same way my mother would, who's 90, almost 90 years old, and play this for my nephew who's only 9, and they would understand it, you know, the same way, because it appeals to a much broader sense, and I think from a communication type of, you know, way, it just it's more fulfilling, I think.
Do you think the expansion of club culture globally has limited people's perception of what electronic is or should be?
Well, I think we let it limit us, actually. I think that because in independent dance music, we're quite free, and you know, we're not prevented from doing things that we really want to do. If you don't like DJ Magazine's top 10, you can make your own. If you don't like a club that's doing something that you think is playing shitty music, you can start your own club and have your own DJs and do your. So we've always had this freedom, but somehow we tend to let the more colorful opinions kind of shape in a seemingly status quo of our industry. And we were talking about this behind the stage, and I think a lot of us in electronic music, we have made the mistake and let certain topics go on without confronting them and telling the truth, actually, because, you know, for fear that maybe you may not be liked, or you may be attacked, or there may be a backlash. For a long time, we haven't said certain things about certain things that is actually the truth about this industry.
Along those lines, when you see people discussing your own work or talking about you as an artist and say, you know, Jeff Mills, techno pioneer or something like that, do you feel like that's not encapsulating everything that you do in a proper way?
Well, I mean, it's something that it doesn't resonate. You know, because I still have problems trying to find the note in the chord. You know, sometimes I can't. So you know, I'm still learning, actually. You know, and I think any musician would agree that you never stop learning. You know, your craft. So you know, there are certain things in this industry that are the way that they are because for reasons outside of the artistry of electronic music, we don't really speak up, we don't really say too much about it, and it just goes on, and it's become accepted as a norm. You know, I'm part of a large community of people that make electronic music all around the world, and my contributions, it's hard to even say whether my contributions are more than really anyone else's, because it's hard to measure. So yeah.
Getting back to the project, the Rembrandt House, I'm curious, you know, we talked a bit about your setup, but, you know, we see here in the video, you had the book, you know, with, are those Rembrandt paintings in the book? And, you know, throughout, I was watching the stream this morning, you'll, you know, periodically kind of flip through and look at the images. I'm curious, was there specific paintings you were looking at? Had you planned those in advance? Tell me a bit about that.
Yeah, there were about five or six of his paintings. Most of them were portraits, and most were of people that had a questionable face expression. And it was really, the eyes were quite questionable. And then there was one a painting of sailors in a ship that were being taken over by the sea. And so there was a lot of distress. And I was using those to create the soundtrack for that, for those pages.
Why paintings where people have questionable facial expressions? Because is it because those are more open to interpretation about?
Yeah, it's just more ambiguous, so you don't really know, and it's easier to approach it from many different.
You can't see it right now, but also there was, you know, Rembrandt's canvas was in front of you, and it didn't have one of his paintings on it, but it did have some like colors. And watching this morning, I was like, what is that on the canvas? Maybe you could explain.
What painters do is that when they're using certain colors, they put a backdrop behind that so that it would reinforce the color. What the Rembrandt house did for their customers is that to put this this foundation, I guess, so when they're on tour, they can explain the reason why it's that way, and that was there. So it's just a large canvas with just solid colors of like a brown and white. So
when you got into the space this morning, did you run into any unexpected challenges or things that you didn't anticipate?
No. I mean, I've been planning for about 4 months. Throughout the whole summer, I traveled with a small recording setup in my luggage, and I would record in my hotel room before I went to the party and after I went to the party. What I was doing was testing to see the limits of what I could create with at least the smallest pieces of equipment possible. So I've been testing the idea for quite some time. And knew exactly what the setup was going to be at this time, and then tested it the night before I came here just to make sure that everything was working. So
the music we're hearing in the background is basically an edited down version of some of what you recorded this morning. Because you had 4 hours of audio, how did you parse that down into something more manageable at the end?
My objective was to make compositions, but then what I really wanted to do was make something like a symphonic score. It's a soundtrack of about 21 minutes, and I think it's more listenable in that way rather than going to silence and then starting another track.
Do you anticipate doing anything further with the music you recorded today, or is that to be determined, or is it just it was an experience that happened today and that's it?
No, this is the first of a type of thing that I'm quite interested in. So the next thing that we're working on is a soundscaping project in Madrid. Of a temple that's located in the center of the city that was given to Spain by Egypt as a gift in the late 60s, and the idea is first I need to explain the temple is of the Egyptian god Amun, and Amun was like Osiris. He was a super god, and he was the god of wind. And this was the temple that was dedicated to him in southern Egypt, many you know, thousands of years ago. And my idea is to create compositions at each point leading up into the temple under arches, the three arches, and then composing music at the front of the temple, and then making music inside of the temple. And then later that evening, we'll have probably a performance with an audience to capture the ambience of the space itself. And then another project that I'll probably test in January will be a recording on the ocean. And the idea is to have one boat 1 mile in that direction, 1 mile in this direction, and to capture it in the center, to see how sound travels across the, certain frequencies travel across the water.
How do you manage to just even intellectually prepare all of these projects simultaneously? Because it's not like, preparing something like this is not like preparing for a DJ gig, I would imagine. You know, it requires a lot of planning and research sometimes. And, you know, for you to balance all this, and I know, you know, you had the residency at the Louvre earlier this year, and you do, you know, there was a performance of the Woman in the Moon soundtrack in San Francisco. It just seems like a lot to balance all at the same time, while also touring and doing, you know, more dance music DJ gigs. How do you juggle all of that?
Well, you prepare and you plan. I mean, you the seven days a week, 24 hours a day, you know, I'm convinced that we've only just scratched the surface of what's really possible with electronic music, and that it's a bit too easy to assume that everything has been done, and I just keep having ideas of what to do with it, where to take it, how to try to expand it, especially with the idea that knowing that if someone sees this, they may expand upon it and take it even further. So that's even more attractive.
I want to ask you about taking electronic music into, let's just say, creative zones or spaces or institutions that are considered high art. You know, when we talk about the Louvre, when we talk about your work with various symphonies and orchestras, you know, a lot of people think about electronic music and they just immediately associate with the club and hedonism and that environment. But do you think that, you know, when you say that there's a lot more places to explore, do you think that these high art venues is a viable way to go?
Well, I think that it depends on who you ask. If you ask a, you know, most 21-year-old person about electronic music, they're going to say the club. But if you ask a 65-year-old person who likes electronic music, he's not going to say the club. He's going to say the museum. He's going to say a place where he can go to in the daytime because he's asleep at 10 o'clock at night. So, and like we were saying before, the majority of people that listen to music, and especially electronic music, are not 21-year-old kids. As time goes on, the body of people that listen to electronic music actually gets older and further away from the dance floor than we probably want to imagine. And so creating these type of things probably appeal to more people than than the strobe light. So, it's just kind of like common sense. If you add it up, the dance floor can only hold so many people, right? I mean, so many people are only going on the weekends. But music has been accessible and free for anyone to have. So, you know, you have to just kind of imagine.
I mean, you've been involved in electronic music in various forms for over 30 years now. Do you give thought to, like, I hate using this cliche phrase, but aging gracefully, you know? Because I feel like there's other DJs who have been around that long who aren't necessarily embarking on, like, interesting projects or anything like that.
But if I thought about electronic music as like a sport, and I was concerned about, you know, having the strength in order to be able to mix two records together, or, you know, the mental focus, then I might be worried. I might be concerned about the 21-year-old who's faster than me, or I might be concerned about, you know, things that age has a way of. But that's not the case. Actually, it's very far from it. And the impression that older DJs feel frustrated because we are older is just something that's just, it's not true. And all the older DJs that I know, are actually the most happy because we realized that we were successful at actually making a career out of doing something that we love, and we're continuing to do it. And we've reached a certain point where we can count on certain things. We know our craft. We know how to make dance music. We travel the world. We know certain markets. We know how to survive, basically, in the music industry, which is not an easy thing to do. So it's not really the case. And this is what I was speaking about earlier. Some things are often not discussed and not said. But the reality is that in this case, age actually is an asset. There are some cities I played in well over 200 times. I played in London maybe 300 times in London as a DJ, just working in London. Or in Berlin, I can't even tell you. It must have been four or 500 times I played in these cities. And so things, you know, you gain a lot of knowledge about places when you do that. And it helps when you are trying to tell stories with music and you understand how this industry works. When you're 21 years old and you may be a great DJ, but there's an awful lot to learn about it. And the older you get, you know, you realize that this is a special art form. It's a special business. It's not like working in an office or anything like that. You enhance yourself by the more experiences that you have. And what it will eventually result to is something that I'll probably never fully understand. But it's apparent that with the more knowledge I have, the more options I have in order to be able to speak to people. So
I'm curious. Do you still follow along what other artists are doing? Like, are you listening to promos? Are you, you know, seeing what the hot new trend is? Or are you just singularly focused on your own work?
Yeah, of course I do. Yeah. I've played music, you know, all of my adult life. It's all that I know. I watch any and everything, everybody, what they're doing, what they're not doing, looking at the industry as a whole to see the type of things that would help us, but that we are too busy concerned about other things and trying to speak to other people about doing certain things, or if not, just do it myself. I'm constantly watching everything, everywhere, Detroit, Berlin, New York, LA, Rio de Janeiro, Tokyo, but that's normal for any DJ that's been around.
I want to ask a little bit more about the Rembrandt project. So in the sounds we're hearing now and the, you know, recordings you made, was all of this, were all of these sounds you created with the gear you had, or were you actually, were you doing field recordings and then processing them in some way?
It was all created this morning. So there was nothing in the machine, there's nothing, everything was clean and everything was created the moment at 9 o'clock.
And it was not a sunny day today. I saw an interview that you had done beforehand about this project, and you were talking about how the light, you know, would affect your work, but, you know, it was gray outside. So did that color the music that you made?
No, it didn't happen. No, there was no sun. So instead, I pretty much looked at his paintings in his catalog so the music, the soundtrack, really consists of about 5 tracks of those 5 images, and I tried my best as much as I could to tell the story of what I was thinking that these people were thinking of, possibly thinking about, in these images, the feeling of it.
Occasionally on the stream, I could see you would step away from your setup and you'd walk around to different points of the room or kind of lean up against the wall. And I'm just curious, you know, what you were doing in those down times where you weren't pushing buttons.
Listening mostly, because the sound is different in different parts of the room. But I was curious what was happening outside the window, actually. And how people were reacting to the museum itself. I mean, be surprised how many people, when they walk by, they look at the place, just notice the place. People come just standing and they're just looking at the house because I guess they, you know. And so I was curious to know what activity was happening outside the window.
Did any of that filter into the music you were making?
I mean, it's to know that you know, outside of that window, outside of those walls, there's something completely happening that's completely different from what's happening inside that room. And it's just a way to...
Without getting too technical, I'm curious how this space compares to your studio that you normally work in terms of, like, do you work... You know, do you have windows in your studio? Is there a lot of light? Is there a huge racks of gear around you, or?
I don't think I've ever thrown out a keyboard ever. So the room is filled with every keyboard that I've probably ever owned in other parts, in Chicago, in other parts of the house. There's one window, which is the reason why I chose that room, and the mixing console, which is really important, faces a wall where there's nothing on it. So normally I have lots of records and books and many other things around on the surrounding walls, but not the wall where the mixing console is located. That wall has to remain blank because. That's the wall when I'm facing when I'm making music, and I don't want anything to draw my attention. If I would prefer to have something blank, where I can use my imagination to imagine that.
So this experience then of having things directly to look at is a departure from your usual production routine.
Yeah, I mean, I studied a little bit of Salvador Dali, learning mathematically how to map distance and space to in order to be able to look at this to look at that frame, so just to understand how to calculate in a numeric sense and then how to relate that to the sounds.
Thematically, a lot of music that you've made, there's been a lot of discussion about your interest in science fiction. You know, and looking towards the future, or even, you know, you've scored movies that, you know, are 80 years old, but then, you know, are designed to be depicting the future. But this project is seemingly more rooted in the past. Is that, how did that affect your creative process?
I mean, not much. I mean, it's hard to say that, you know, this chair is from the, you know, the 16th century or something like that. I mean, I try my best to translate the feeling of being in the room, and also, you know, also the context in which I'm working, and try to find some type of narrative to tell the story about how this happened. And you know, the more I do these type of things, the better I'm going to get at it. So if I continue, the same thing happened in working with cinema, making cinema mixes. The first one I did was Metropolis back in 2000, and maybe I was lucky on that one, but it took a while to create that soundtrack. But as I begin to do them more, The Cheat by Cecil B. DeMille, October by Sergei Eisenstein, Fantastic Voyage, Richard Fleischer, Woman in the Moon. I just recently did Berlin Symphony of a Great City, which is a documentary I've done. Etudes à Paris, another documentary. I get better at the process of describing things within a frame, moving images, the tempo, recognizing the depth of field, and all those things. In this case, the more I do these soundscaping type of things, it's going to lead somewhere, I think.
Would you ever be interested in doing a brand new soundtrack for a new piece of film? And have you ever been approached, by Hollywood or anything like that?
No, not by Hollywood, but for a few films. I've done some work with Claire Denis in Paris, a few other smaller things, but nothing major. So.
Do you have any favorite soundtrack artists that you enjoy, or have enjoyed over the years of note?
Well, I mean, from my youth, John Williams is maybe I'm more inspired by him than say Kraftwerk or Juan Atkins, because he's done so much. I mean, from TV commercials to all the major famous science fiction films to everything. He's probably played more of a role in electronic music than probably people even realize, because as kids, when we were growing up in Detroit, we were listening to a lot of his music. We weren't listening to techno or electronic. We weren't listening to progressive music because first of all, we couldn't afford it if you're 7 years old. But you were watching TV. You're listening to his commercials. You're watching his work on science fiction films. I don't think it's by coincidence that a lot of us from Detroit are all around the same age because of the influence of that.
Listening to the music that you recorded in the background now, we talked a bit about how it's not dance music, but it's also not, I mean, when we were talking before the interview, I made the mistake of calling it atmospheric, and you said it's not atmospheric music, it's not ambient music, it's soundtrack music. And maybe you could talk a bit about what you see the differences and why you think it is soundtrack music and not those other things.
Well, my reply was that sometimes we don't do a very good job at categorizing pieces of work, and that it's just very easy to just say anything without drums or percussion falls in the ambient atmospheric type of category, which is I like to think that we are more knowledgeable about music, if we've been in it for a very long time, to be able to distinguish the difference between atmospheric and ambient. And that really depends on what the objective was. So I wasn't trying to create a very serene atmosphere. I was trying to translate the lines, the colors, the textures in the paintings of Rembrandt. So it's more of a soundtrack type project.
What in particular about Rembrandt's colors and lines stood out to you and, you know, made you want to translate that into music?
Well, I mean, again, like I said earlier, he really excelled at capturing the moment, and a lot of the paintings were not based on posing, but it was just capturing real life at that time. So, I thought that's quite attractive.
You talked a bit about films, and obviously, you're someone who's, you know, a student of film and a big fan of film. Do you still watch, is films like a big part of your routine, your daily routine?
Yes.
What is your Netflix queue like? Or do you watch?
No, I mean, yeah, I watch a lot of films. We can talk about some other things if you guys don't mind. We can talk about some things that
What do you have in mind?
Well, I think, what I think probably makes more sense, maybe have more value, is to talk about where we're all headed in terms of electronic music. Where exactly is it going? Where could it go? What are the elements that we would need in order to be able to go somewhere? I mean, we can party 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, but what is being produced as a result? How is it changing us as people? I mean, if you take a kid that was 21, you know, in 1990, and this kid's 35 years old, he's beyond the age of, he's into his life, you know, he's into his career. How is dancing every weekend, listening to music with no vocals, instrumental music, playing a role, and how is it going to play a role when he's 65 years old? That could be a question.
What? Well, why don't you answer it?
We don't have to be so formal. We can really. Sure. I mean, we're all related. If you're here for this festival, then we're all related somehow. And I think. There are, as a DJ, there are many things happening in the club setting. It's not just lights flashing and strobe lights and big sound systems. We know because we, as DJs, we know because we're watching you hour after hour, night after night. We know what is conditioning you and the reasons why you're coming back again. And we know what to do, how to make that even better. Interesting things are happening and emerging from, I can go all the way back to the mid-80s, to the rave culture, and this idea that thousands of people coming together for one reason, music, is something that did not really exist, since the 60s. You know? And so this may play a role in how we may act and how we may get together in the future. The idea of not being told something, but something being insinuated to the point that you begin to understand what it is what we've been doing for literally 30 years. So music has no vocals. We insinuate things with notes and chords and drum patterns, and it works. This universal communication that's happening. So so from there, many different things are possible, I think.
What kind of messages are you hoping to communicate through your own music? I'm sure it varies from project to project, but are there sort of uniting themes that you want to communicate with your own art?
Well, I mean, I'm very realistic. You can't do it all, and I realized this back in the mid '90s that it's better to specialize in one particular thing, even though it's electronic music. It's better to specialize in one particular thing, so that I could spend the rest of my life trying to master it, rather than do three or four things and not have enough time to really spend time. And so back then I decided to first get very serious about what I was doing about music, and the idea of going back to college and going back to school was out of the window. I decided then that I needed to do the things and do them in the way that will allow me to be able to do this indefinitely. So I got very serious about it. I began to understand more about the way that the industry works. As an artist, what does an artist need to do in order to be able to give the impression that I know what I'm talking about so that I can gain your confidence? So at that time, I stopped making as many 12 inches and concentrated on making albums, because those are more of a composite of many different ideas, and they're made for you to be able to listen to from the beginning to the end, and it tells a story, and you have more chances to put your personality into it rather than a 5-minute track. So these are very practical things. And I realized that times are going to change, and that a major point is that our future, it's always been uncertain from the very beginning. But I think that this century we will be tested a lot by many different things. And I think that space, of course, is one subject that I work on a lot. But it's not space, it's the idea of humans being in space and not knowing what to do is what I'm more concerned about. So the more knowledge I can give them, the more subjects I can make music about space and planets and things, in a way it's kind of, I think that I'm helping to prep people to face things that they're not quite used to. So being on a planet is like being in front of a person that you never met, or encountering a situation that you've never been in. And understanding something that, or being faced with something that you just don't know, if you get used to that, then you know the impact is not as strong. You should find yourself to be more accepting of things that you don't understand. So I love space. I'm very much into science fiction, but it's actually It's a subtitle. Actually, the title is actually us in these scenarios, in these situations.
All right. Well, I could keep asking questions all day, but unfortunately, we have run out of time. So, I want to thank Jeff Mills for coming, and thank everyone for coming.